with y'all all day. All right.
And we recorded it.
Now, I've got a special request tonight from Jason Cloud. And he wanted his mama, Gloria, and he wanted Becky and Joan to sing special. Becky Cloud thought it was her, and that was Becky Hurst. Now I see where she's at. She left. She got flung out here. But the song that we tried to sing, I didn't know it, but the one I wanted to sing was on page 197. If I can get my piano players back up, I'm going to try to lead this one. And I want the ladies just to stand up, and I want y'all to sing one. The men to sing too. Page 197 in this blue book here. And, Vicky, you come leave the ladies in 1 and 3, okay? 197. Just come here. 197 in this book here. Vicky, you take the lead for the women and I'll take the lead to the men. Y'all go ahead and sing 1 and 2, and we'll sing 3 and 4. That way they just want to stand right there. 197. 197 in this book. Just start singing. Follow the lead. Tonight we didn't go, but we're supporting them. 100% is Carly and Chelsea, we're the three. Of course, Stephen's in Oakdale. I don't know if they have in theirs tonight.
They are.
So Stephen's down in Oakdale tonight. Let's just, I think what we need to do, I think it'd be appropriate for us to just pray for them right now. Because, you know, they're graduating high school and they've been a part of the Bend County. And my heart's toward those three. They're graduating. So let's pray for them. Just, we're not with them tonight in the back, Lord. Let's pray for them. So, Brother Ken, would you lift these three up?
Father, we come to you from the heart, Father, just thanking you for being in our lives and being in our midst this season, Father. Father, I pray for those seniors now, Father, that you be not only working their lives, Father, but to be the main part of their lives, Father, that they turn to you for direction and guidance in everything they do in life, Father. Father, I pray for those parents who are nurturing their Father in the way of the Lord, Father. I pray that they'll give them the proper guidance they need, Father, to continue on in life. Father, with you being the greatest part in their lives, Father, as they go out into the world, Father, just ask that you lead, guide, and direct their steps. Everything that they do is safe, Father. Father, they too, Father, lead others to Christ and be bold to be able to speak the name of Jesus. Father, not be ashamed in any way, just be bold to speak the name. Father, we thank you, we love you, we praise you this night. Father, we just thank you for being present with us here tonight. Father, walk with those three as they walk. Father, let them turn to you in everything that they do. Father, and be with us as Brother Danny brings the words of truth to God. Let it be your word, not his, Father. Father, let us receive that word in our minds and our hearts. In Jesus' holy and blessed name we pray. Amen.
Take your Bible also and open up to Colossians chapter 2, and then we'll look back in Genesis a little bit too. But I want to talk to you a little bit tonight about the three institutes that God ordained for us to enjoy and to experience. Of course, in Genesis chapter 2, the first institute that he ordained was marriage. If you'll look with me in that scripture, Genesis 2, and look with me in verse 18. And the Lord God said, "It's not good that the man should be alone. I will make him an helpmeet for him." Genesis 2, verse 18. And out of the ground the Lord formed every beast and field and every fowl of the air and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call him. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. And Adam gave names to all the cattle and fowl of the air and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found an helpmeet for him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman, and brought her to the man. And Adam said, "This is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of a man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh." And they were both naked, and the man and his wife were not ashamed. And the reason I want to just bring you back to where we're at this morning is that the Lord God created planet Earth. He created it for men. And he didn't create the sun first. He created the earth first. It was a habitat for men to live in that were created after God's image. And the order and the priority of his creation is phenomenal. And the lesser lights and the greater lights, and the fourth day of creation created the sun, then the moon, the lesser lights to rule the night, and the moon is a reflection off the sun. And then in Psalms 8, it said, when I consider the handiwork of God, they all testify of what God, how God and what he created, and they give witness to who we are. And it's quite amazing. Well, God gave something else for men. Keep in mind that God loved us. He put us here. He gave Adam dominion over all the fowl, the beast, and he created marriage, and And then in, after the flood, what did he do? He created civil government. He told who? Shamnam and Japheth to go out all over the planet Earth and subdue the earth and repopulate the earth. And then he ordained civil government. They were to rule over all flesh and rule over all the animals. And it was an amazing thing. There's another institute that God created. And I want you to keep in mind now, we have a great God. And he saw all these things. Matter of fact, he was absolutely did not, nothing did catch him by surprise.
Amen.
He was not asleep when he created us. He knew that we were going to have to be redeemed, that we would fall. He was all aware of that. But he created you and I so that we could have dominion and rule and reign and be sons of God. Right. That's quite amazing. Matter of fact, it's quite amazing to know that the heavens, the sun, the moon, are ours. That he created the stars, the sun, for us to be able to plant, to be able to know the difference in the seasons. It's quite amazing the power and what God did for us. Amen? Amen. Now the problem is we don't know who we are. We don't know what we are. And when we realize who we are and what we are, and we get a good glimpse of what he's done for us, it changes the whole paradigm of how we think and how we operate and what we do. Because you know what? We got a bright future. Praise God.
Amen.
You know, the world's falling all apart and they all worried and all perplexed and all these things. But I know who holds tomorrow is God.
Amen.
I know who holds me in his hand is God. And I also know there's nothing, no power in heaven, under the earth, in the sea. There's no principality, nothing going to be able to take me and you. He loves us that much out of his hand.
Amen.
When I consider the stars, the sun, the moon, and when I consider the moon becoming beautiful at night, getting its illumination from the sun, I realized through God's handiwork who I am. That he created us in the sixth day, and he created this planet for us to live on. The Holy Ghost come over the earth, which was without form, void, and dark. He moved over the waters of the earth, and he brought light. The Holy Ghost brought light, not the sun and the moon. The earth was created for the Lord Jesus to come in 2,000 years ago, to come down and robe himself in the form of sinful flesh to redeem what he created in Adam, who was made after the very split image of God. I'm also aware of what he told Peter. The third institute that God ordained and he created was the institute of the church. Now don't think that the church is not important to God. Because Jesus, who is the creator, told Peter, when Peter recognized that he was the Son of God, he said, upon this rock I'll build my church. And the church is very important in the eyes of God. Praise God.
Yeah.
It wasn't Peter that he was going to build his church. It was on Christ that he built his church. Through Christ. We have marriage, we have civil government, and we have the church. And God ordained all three things for you and I. Don't think that he's not in charge. Don't think he's asleep. Don't think he's went AWOL. God is very much in the program.
Yeah.
And he's coming back to rule and reign on planet Earth and we with him. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
But keep this in mind. Satan is still on the warpath. Satan is seeking to whom he may devour every day. He is a roaring lion. But Jesus knocked his teeth out. And the only way he can get any prey is when we get afraid and we start running from the principles and the oracles and the teachings of the Bible. Because really and truly, all the old lions do when they run through the jungle is that they scream and yell and run the prey out of the bushes and the young lions eat them. But if we run to Jesus, that old Lucifer, that old dragon, the old Slewfoot can't get us, praise God.
Amen.
Draw nigh unto God and what? The devil will flee from you. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Yeah.
He is in charge, the Lord. The book of Colossians, if you have your Bibles, chapter 2. Through Adam, sin entered the world. Adam, do you realize that Adam did not have a mother or father? Do you realize Eve did not have a mother? Do you realize Christ did not have an earthly father? But you and I, we all that are born today, all individuals have a mother and father. That's how we got here. Praise God. How were we redeemed? We were redeemed by Christ through the seed of the woman who was without an earthly father, but he had a heavenly father. Praise God for his plan. Amen. Are you aware of what he's done for us? Are you aware of who he is? Now, the problem is a lot of people don't know who he is. They don't know who Jesus is and what he's done for us. Number one, who is he? Number two, what did he do for us? Well, let's look in Colossians chapter 2, and we're going to see some sweet things in Colossians chapter 2. Number 1, verse 4 of chapter 2, this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. You know what? In the last few years, liberalism has promised a lot, hasn't it? Socialism promises a lot. Matter of fact, the first socialist was who? That I think in this dispensation. Who was he? Judas. He had the bag. When they bought all the money out and wanted to anoint Jesus' feet, Mary bought the money out, what did he say? Hey, that could have been sold for a lot of money, and let's spread the wealth. You see, socialism don't help either, does it? Amen. Socialism, I believe, it comes from the enemy, Satan. And we do have in America those who would want to bring in socialism in our country. And we do have those who want to bring in liberalism in our country. And here's what Jesus is saying. Here's what Paul is saying right in Colossians. Beware, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. You know what? America has failed for this enticing words. They really like the sound of it. You know what? Government's going to take care of you from the time you're born until the time you die. Enticing words. Liberalism does not work. Socialism does not work. Matter of fact, some of the communist countries are realizing that, and they're letting a few of the folks have capitalism. So beware, church. Make sure that what you're hearing, what you're learning, what you're knowing comes out of the Bible. When a nation forgets God, what happens? They're turned where? Into hell. Amen. Amen. Verse number 8. You see, Satan is subtle. There's many wiles that he does. There's many things that Satan does to try to throw us. The Bible tells us real clear in Ephesians that we have to stand against the wiles of who? Satan. We're to beware. Read your Bible. Church, read your Bible. Know what the enemy's doing. Know the ways of the Lord. You know, Christians in America today need to wake up. You know, we've lost the battle in politics. We've lost the battle in the political realm because the church don't know who they are. They don't know who Jesus is. They don't know the teachings of the Bible. And guess what? We're being beguiled. We like the sound of big government. We like the sound of government taking care of us. But to me, all government does is it let every man be free to worship the Lord and serve the Lord. And you know what? When we love the Lord and serve the Lord and things fall in place, our economy is going to fix itself, praise God. Government will never fix our economy. It's people that love the Lord and know how to serve and love and industrious. And I believe God is industrious. I believe God wants his people to be industrious. You saw this morning that God is very creative. I believe when the Holy Ghost of God lives in men and the church has revival and America has revival, that's what's going to cure our country. But the scripture is real clear right here. It says that we are to watch out now. Don't let no man beguile you. Liberalism, socialism won't work. Philosophy won't work. You know, there's a lot of philosophers in the country today, and our churches are full of psychologists and philosophers, and they're learning more and more and learning less and less, and they're getting more ignorant. Amen. I didn't get no amens on that. A few. There's a few of you that caught that. Philosophy, look at it in verse 8. Learning more and more, but learning less and less. Beware, verse 8. Satan's very crafty. The wiles of Satan. Beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after what? Christ. Now guess what? Some tradition is good, but some tradition is not good. Tradition that's against Christ is no good, no value. It brings death. It brings no life. Legalism is no value. You know what legalism is? I read a good picture of legalism today. A good allegory picture of what true legalism really is. It's having a picture of God, looking at the picture, and having God in your heart and looking at a picture. Like the Old Testament. You caught it, didn't you? Legalism is looking at the laws of God, trying to keep the laws of God, and just as the Old Testament types, the law was a picture of who God really is, and we still want to look at the law of God, not knowing who we are and what we have Christ in us, and we're still trying to fall back into legalism. Beware. Satan has a lot of folks, many folks trapped in that today. You know, there's a lot of religious folks trapped in legalism today. And here's what he's saying. Beware now. Now look at this real close, because also, if you look with me in verse 18, let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he has not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. Mysticism. That's the light within you. That's your own humanism and mysticism. Guess what? The light that we have is illuminated by the Word of God. The light that we have is empowered by the Holy Spirit. Praise God. Idolatry is rampant in America today. Look at verse 20. Wherefore, if you be dead with Christ from the rudiments of the world, why, as though living in the world, are you subject to ordinances, asceticism? Folks are subject to ordinances. Folks are bound in idolatry. I know where I get my joy from. It comes from the Lord. I know where I get my happiness from. It comes from God. I know where my strength and power is. It comes from a living God that's alive. He's much alive in my spirit and in my heart. Walk in the Lord Jesus Christ. Turn from idolatry. Now, can you imagine what Jesus has done for us? Who is he? He spoiled principalities and powers. Look at Colossians, if you would. Now, I want you to look who he is now. And we get a good, clear picture of what Jesus is and who he is and what he's done. Look with me in verses 14 and 15 now. What did he do? Verse 14. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. There are some things that Adam didn't hear. There are some words he didn't know when he was created. He could call every animal by name. I think it was 3,500 mammals and just hundreds and hundreds of fowl. And he named them all in one day, and the next day he remembered their names. But there are some things that Adam didn't know. There are some words he hadn't heard of before, and one of them was death. He never heard the word death. He didn't know what death was. But don't you know something? Jesus took that and nailed it to the cross. We couldn't keep the law. We couldn't keep fellowship with God. Adam and Eve couldn't keep fellowship with God, and they failed. They never heard the word death. But guess what? Jesus Christ came 2,000 years ago. Who is he? Through Adam. He fell. Death was introduced through Adam. You weren't born to die. You were born to live. But because Adam fell, death was introduced, but Jesus Christ took it. Look what it says here in this verse, and I hope you understand who he is. What did he do? He took this ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. Not only that, but he spoiled, verse 15, he spoiled principalities and what? Powers. He made a show of them openly, triumphing over them. We don't have time. For the sake of time, we're going a little bit late. But I want you to know one thing, that when he was on the cross, one word that Adam never knew was nakedness. He was naked, but he didn't understand what being naked was. But the Lord Jesus Christ gave his garment. He became naked for us, that he took that ordinance that was against us, those words that Adam never knew when he first created us. He took that word nakedness and he became naked for us. He exposed himself that you and I might live. Praise God. Who is he? He took death and spoiled it. He took nakedness and spoiled it. Praise God. This is what Colossians is saying here. If you'll just think about what's going on here in this particular scripture. Beware now. Beware. Humanism is not going to help you. Liberalism is not going to help you. Socialism is not going to help you. Beware now. Don't be spoiled with all these vain philosophies and idolatry and all these things that comes along and says to you, hey, here's how you're going to find happiness. Here's how you're going to be redeemed. Here's how you're going to be saved. The religious world, the political world is being spoiled today. Church, wake up. If America's going to be saved, we're going to have to be the savor and the salt of this land. Revival starts when people gain a knowledge who Jesus is, and then they realize who they are, and what they have is what God did for us at the cross through His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. He spoiled principalities. He spoiled powers. That's who He is. He's Lord of Sabbath. Praise God. I'm excited about that. Are y'all realizing that? Not only that, but He took the thorns, didn't He? What did He do? What, when the curse, Adam and Eve never knew anything about a curse. But the Bible says Jesus Christ became a what for us? A curse. He took that word curse and became a curse and spoiled it, praise God. He took the curse that you and I had on us. What's going to happen in the millennial reign? Anybody know? What's going to happen in the 1,000 years rule of the millennial reign? Anybody got a clue? What does the Bible say about it? There will be no more thorns or nestles. And a child can play on a wasp nest and not get stung. He took the curse off the ground. The water's going to come at a certain time. The earth's going to be watered. The desert's going to turn into streams of water. There will be water flowing out of Mount Zion. There will be no more droughts. There will be no more curses on this land. Women will have children without pain. He took the curse. He spoiled that. Praise God. Who is He? He spoiled things that destroyed me and you through Adam. He took the curse. Praise God. He became a curse for us. Hallelujah. Who are we? That a God would die for us and spoil those things that were nailed against us and that was ordinances against us. He took it away. Praise God. It's an amazing thing that the modern church wants to take the blood out of our song services. It's too archaic. It's too sadistic. We're more modern. We're more upbeat. Woo! That old religion is good enough for me, praise God. I'm still excited about it. I glory in it, praise God. I'm excited about these old songs that we sing, Brother Lloyd. Brother Lloyd has a wealth of these old songs in his spirit and heart. Somebody taught him right. Brother Lloyd has words that minister. Now, I don't know if you appreciate what he was doing, what he was singing tonight, but I do. You don't find that everywhere in the country no more. Matter of fact, the modern church don't want that kind of music no more. I love it. Those songs that we sang tonight minister deep in my spirit. And it's going to come back around. After a while, you know things go in cycles. After a while, folks are going to realize that the modern music we have today is dead and empty, and they're not feeding the Spirit then. And you know what? If you come back 20 years from now, they'll be craving for music that we sing at this church. I think I'm off my rocker, don't you? They will. It'll come back around. It will. Amen. I believe it to be so. Now, that's what I believe, and you don't have to believe like I do, but that's what I believe. Y'all know I'll get out there sometime. But I do know one thing. This is the right music. It's got messages in it. Sorrow. God took that and did all away with it. There'll be no more sorrow. There'll be no more death and pain and sorrow. Folks won't have to go around with the head dropped down because situations and circumstances. We won't have to feel arthritis. We won't have to feel the heartbreak of financial problems. We won't have to feel the heartbreak of things not going right. Can I tell you what? Jesus took the curse and He took away sorrow and He became a curse for us. Praise God. And I'm so happy that He took those things and nailed them to the cross and He took away those ordinances that was against me and you. Praise God. I'm also very much aware that He also, as God put a curse on us that men shall earn their living by the sweat of the brow, that I'm also aware that when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane, they said He agonized so much that He became sweat for us. The Bible says that He sweat great drops as if they were blood. Cardiologists say that when you sweat great drops that is like they are blood coming out of your body, that you're actually having a heart attack. I want you to know tonight that when He was in the Garden of Gethsemane praying for us, that sweat, He took that sweat curse right off us, and one day when we get into the millennial reign, I believe, Brother Jeff, if you like to work, you'll be able to work night and day without sweating. Whatever you do that God's given you to do in the millennial reign, there'll be no more sweat, there'll be no more curse. plant life will be flesh again and flourishing again, because Jesus Christ took those ordinances that was nailed against us and he nailed them to the cross. And praise God, he became a blessing for us at the cross. All our blessings began at the cross. Praise God. I know who he is. I know what he's done. And I know who I am. I have the living God shut up in my bones. And the reason I have passion and something stirring, boiling up in me, because I have a living God, which is a living creator. The reason I get excited about preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, because I know what I'm preaching. I know who he is. I know what's in me. I know what he's done for me. I know I have a bright future. I know who God is. Praise God. The reason you come back tonight and you're here at Elizabeth Baptist Church, because you know to whom you serve. You know to whom you love. You know who's the God of creation. You know what Jesus did for you. You know who he is tonight. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. I believe the church today, and I believe the modern church is really archaic. I believe we're the modern church today. We're the modern church that knows Jesus Christ, because he's not old, he's fresh. Praise God. We are the modern church today. Praise God. That's praising Jesus Christ. We are the institution of the church. We are what Peter recognized when he told Jesus that you are Christ, you're the Son of the living God. And we are what Jesus told Peter: upon this rock I will build my church. I know who he is. He took the curse and he spoiled it. Praise God. Hallelujah. I'm excited about that tonight. But a lot of folks don't know him. A lot of folks will go to church tonight and it'll just be a little ho-hum, good social meeting, and it won't mean nothing, because there's no life in it. I know Jesus has the answer for me tonight. I know he took it. Turn with me to the book of Galatians, if you would. I'm going to read this final scripture. And I want you to go home tonight, and I want you to pray that the Lord would bless us in such a supernatural way at this church, that we've just beginning to see what he has done for us and who he is. I want you to know tonight, he took our curses away. He took our curse of sweat away from us. He took the thorns away. You don't see it now, friend, but one day we're going to walk through a golden time and a golden land. We're going to walk through a land that has no thorns. We're going to walk through a land that has no deserts. We're going to walk through a land that has no wasps and no hornets. We're going to walk through a land where there's going to be perfection. We're going to walk through a land where there's going to be a righteous judge, Jesus Christ. We're going to walk through a land. We're going to come to a glorious day. You and I are going to get the wedding present. We're going to go up to be with the Lord Jesus. We're coming back with him. And we're going to rule and reign over a world that was once cursed. But because Jesus Christ took those handwritten ordinances and nailed them to the cross, and it became a curse, you and I are set free from the curse. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. One day we're not going to die again. We've been born again. The second death is not going to have no effect on us. Praise God. If you're here tonight in this church and you've never been born again, you need to be born again. Jesus told Nicodemus that you'll never see the kingdom of God unless you be born again. Brother, how do you know that I'm born again? How do I know that I'm born again? I won't tell you how you know that you're born again. When sin loses hold on you. Well, Brother Dan, nobody's perfect. I didn't say that. I'm saying when you're born again, I'm going to tell you what happens. You receive the Word of God. And there's a birth that comes. And all of a sudden, the powers of sin that held you captive all your life, the shackles begin to be broken off. And for once in your life, you have victory and power over that sin nature that just not held you bondage anymore. Because the Bible says, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. The Bible says that the blood cleanses. The Bible says, if we sin, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses from all sin. I want to tell you what, if you become a different creature. Matthew, who was sitting at the receipt of customs, when he was saved, a tax collector, he told Jesus, hey, you know what? Out of the old law, Old Testament law, if I stole anything from anybody, you know what I'll do? I'll give them four things back. That man changed. Yeah. How do you know if you're born again tonight? You're a new creature in Christ Jesus. You're a different man. You love the Word of God. The Word of God is making sense to you now. You love your Bible. You're hungry and thirsty because there's a spirit man in you that's been born again and is desiring the precious seed, the precious uncorruptible Word of God, which is saving your precious soul. Praise God. God loves you. Who are you? You're a child of a king. The King of Kings. Lord of Lords. That took your sin curse away from us. Now let's read the scripture. Who are you? Who's Jesus? What did he do for you? He took my curse, praise God. He took the sword in his side for me, and that sword was your sword. You should have been split open, and you should have died, but Jesus died in your place. He took the sword for you. He took your sword and died. Look at it. We wear crucifixes on our chains. We wear crucifixes on our belt buckles. We wear crucifixes and we put crucifixes all over our religious establishments. But very few people really know what the cross is. Now, I'm not condemning wearing crosses. Don't get me wrong. But what I want you to know tonight is this. Know what it was. Know what it represents. He became a curse. Look what it says, Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. Christ hath redeemed us. Hallelujah. From what? The curse of the law. I'm not looking at a picture no more. I'm not looking at a picture of the law trying to be saved no more. I have you. I'm not trying to get saved. I am saved. Because of this verse. Being made a curse. Who? Jesus was made a curse. For who? For us. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. Now when you wear your chains and your crosses. I'm not condemning that, but know what it means. Because I'm a gospel preacher. Know that when you wear that, that's a sign of curse. And know that Jesus Christ was cursed for you. And he hung on that tree and he took your punishment. I don't have to kiss a cross. I don't have to have a picture of him. I don't have to fall in religious idolatry. Because I have him here.
Amen.
And I can talk to him every minute. But the Lord talked to us in song tonight. Those old gospel writers knew what it meant to have him in us. I'm not saying this ugly. I don't mean nothing about this, what I'm fixing to say.